Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you a couple of candidates for Lieutenant Governor. One could not be here today, three are announced. Rick Jeffries, Senator Rick Jeffries, had a pre-commitment with one of his family members, and I certainly understand him keeping that. But it is my pleasure to introduce you to you at this time, one of my fellow House members, Representative Geoff Duncan, a candidate for Lieutenant Governor. Geoff, come on up. Appreciate you warming up the audience there for me, Barry. Good morning, fellow conservatives. How are you? It is great to address this crowd. It's an honor for me. It's hard to believe it's already been a year since we've been here. A lot's changed in a year. I'm certain this crowd absolutely understands that. One part I want to highlight is a year ago, Hillary Clinton had all but sized up the curtains in the Oval Office and had probably already lined up a moving van for her and Bill. And now the only thing Mrs. Clinton is lining up are bingo cards on Tuesday night. So we're excited for that, and that's good for America. Running for Lieutenant Governor is something my family and I take very, very seriously, and it's an honor for us. Running statewide can be daunting. Many of you know that. You've driven a long distance to be here. Trying to meet 10 plus million people is a daunting task. But I got to tell you a secret. My family and I are having an absolute blast doing it. We enjoy meeting people. We enjoy the perspective. We think the perspective is priceless for us in putting us on the right road to success to be the next Lieutenant Governor of Georgia. Three questions I get asked everywhere I go is why, how, and when. Why are you running? How are you going to make a difference? And when can I get involved? I think an important place to start, because it is a big question, because I'm not the next guy in line. I should not be the next Lieutenant Governor if you look at the pecking order. Why is a 42-year-old guy married to his high school sweetheart with three great kids in the prime of his business career running statewide? The answer is because I truly believe I can make a positive difference in each and every Georgian's life. I feel like my perspective, my background, my leadership skills are going to give us the opportunities to positively affect this state as an ex-Lieutenant Governor. My background is different than most folks who are here in politics. I started my career playing baseball at Georgia Tech. I got drafted and spent a number of years in the minor leagues with the Florida Marlins organization. And then I ended up writing a business plan knowing that my career would end. And I started a business, grew it, and sold it with my wife. And then we started an entrepreneurial track. And politics, a lot like many of you in this room, segued into my life sitting in a church. A church that challenged me to be more involved in my community, to be a bigger advocate of personal responsibility everywhere I went. I took that challenge, I ran for office. 5 years ago, I got sworn in as the representative from Forsyth County. I'm committed to making a difference. How? There's two parts to how. How am I going to make that difference, and then how am I going to win this race? If I start with how I'm going to make a difference, I think it's important to understand something that became apparent to me when I got sworn in at the General Assembly. I walked in the room thinking that there would just be a room full of God-given leaders bouncing off of each other every which way. What I realized was there was a room full of elected leaders and very few folks that had the ability and skill to see a vision and be able to move an entire mass of people towards that vision. That was the first. The second part that was alarming to me was that so many folks want to talk about championing business principles. It's the cornerstone of my campaign. I've run businesses, I've started businesses, I've sold businesses. I don't see very many business principles going on. I feel like there's an opportunity to do things. If I disagree with you at work, I'm not going to poke you in the eye. I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to try to find consensus. I'm going to work in the facts and figures, and I'm going to convince you that we're the right way to go. The other thing that I think is very important is there's this endless favors game that goes on all over the country, all over this country with inside politics. If you do this, 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 and this, I'll do this. If you do this, 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 and this, I'll do this. It's stifling many of the best ideas we have here in Georgia. We are rewarding good politics over good policy way too often. One of those examples, and many of you are aware of that, is an adoption bill this year. An adoption bill that would have benefited thousands, if not tens of thousands of kids in our adoptive system. Good politics was chosen over good policy. We need to make a change. Talk about transparency. Many of you have written letters to your senators and to other folks around the Senate talking about transparency. You want to be able to see the committee meetings on your own computer in your own communities from the folks that you elected. You want to be able to see how they're engaging in the conversation. I think we need to have that. I think we need to make it immediate. When the state of California state senate is more transparent than the Georgia state senate, you might have a problem. We need to be willing to use new ideas to solve old problems. We need to be the party of ideas. two ideas that I've been able to champion since being in the General Assembly. One is the Cargo Theft Act. When I got sworn in, Georgia was third in the nation in cargo theft. Nobody would have fought it. Organized crime had come here and taken advantage of our laws. They realized if you stole a truck full of cargo, you got penalized for stealing the truck, but not the cargo. And so organized crime had moved in. I took some new ideas, worked with the GBI, were able to produce a bill, and if you steal $1 million or more in cargo now in the state of Georgia, you go to jail for 20 years. Just like if you steal $1 million from that bank, you go to jail for 20 years. One of the best phone calls I got was from the GBI, who called me after the bill had passed for 18 months and said, Representative Duncan, we want to tell you cargo theft is down 68% in 1 year in the state of Georgia. How many of you are from rural communities? Raise your hand. A room full of people. Georgia's built on the backs of these rural communities. I was able to champion a bill for rural health care reform. We're going to be able to produce over $200+ million over the next 3 years to rural Georgia, to 54 rural hospitals, to allow them to decide how they want to not just keep their hospitals' doors open, but to allow them to thrive and be the backbones of your communities. And I thank all the support we got along the way. The second part to how is, how are we going to win this race? Because I'm not the next person in line. If there's ever been a time for a person with my background, with my resume, with my perspective, to win a statewide race, it's right here, right now. Many of you know that in this room. Three things that I'm focused on to win this race is you gotta build the right team. We've done that. Proof is most of the folks running statewide are calling my team, wanting them to come to work for them. I see that as a great compliment. Two is you gotta be committed to the operation. I've stepped down as the CEO of a healthcare company with the sole focus of being the next lieutenant governor of Georgia. There will be no more committed person in this race than Geoff Duncan. Last but not least, we gotta raise the money to make this happen. And we are working hard, long hours on the phone, 8+ hours a day, raising money, and I report to you, we're having great success. I gotta tell you a funny story. This is funny. I'm out on the campaign trail, and one of my opponents was a couple of days out in front of me. And apparently, I vote no too often, according to this person. I vote no too often at the General Assembly, and I'm too conservative to be the next lieutenant governor. And I'm trying to figure out my response. I haven't gotten there yet, but I think I'm just going to thank him. I will never apologize for being conservative, and nobody in this room should ever apologize for being conservative. In closing, we talk about when. When does this race start? The answer is right here, right now. As I mentioned a minute ago, there's nobody, there's never been a better opportunity in America for the folks with my resume, with my background, with my perspective, to be elected to such a great office as Lieutenant Governor. I'm the underdog in this race, I get that. And I hate being the underdog. Many of you hate being the underdog. But I gotta tell you a secret, I'm really good at it. I've been good at it since I've been in school. I was good at it on the baseball field. I was good at it in business, and I'm really good at it in politics. Underestimate me all you want. We're gonna win this race. Let me close with this. Long road ahead for our family. And if you've already convinced that the next person in line's gotta win this race, I respect that. I absolutely respect it. I disagree with it, but I respect it. But if you're looking for somebody who's truly principled, truly conservative, and truly focused on the next generation, Team Duncan, thank you so much. God bless the state of Georgia.
Thank you, Geoff. Next, I have the opportunity to introduce to you another candidate for Lieutenant Governor. This is probably one of the first few people to speak today. I haven't actually served within the State House, but we did go to University of Georgia together. Go Dawgs. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to present to you today the Speaker Pro Tem of the Georgia, excuse me, the President Pro Tem of the Georgia Senate, David Shafer. David?
Thank you very much. The day after the inaugural earlier this year, a man showed up at the front gate of the White House and asked him to see President Barack Obama. And the Marine Guard told him, sir, Barack Obama is no longer the President of the United States. The next day the man showed up again, the same Marine Guard, and he said, I'm here to see President Barack Obama. And the Marine Guard said, Barack Obama is no longer the President of the United States. Third day, he shows up again, the same Marine Guard, and he asks, I'm here to see President Barack Obama. And the guard says, look, I've told you two times before Barack Obama is no longer President of the United States. He said, I know, he said, I just like to hear you say. The United States has a new president, and the left hates him. I'm not talking about disagreement or opposition. They absolutely hate him. And in covering him, the news media has abandoned any pretense of objectivity. They ridicule him when he does exactly what he promised to do. They ridicule him when he does something different. They ridicule him about how many scoops of ice cream he has for dessert. They ridicule him about misspelling a tweet. They hate the man. Why is that? I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why I think they hate him. When I was young, the idea of free speech was explained to me with that famous quote by Evelyn Beatrice Hall. I disapprove of what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it. And that's what I've always believed. That's what I've always understood free speech to mean, the rough and tumble exchange of competitive ideas. I reject most of the criticism of Donald Trump as unfounded and ridiculous. But this is America, and people have the right, the freedom to make these criticisms, and those of us who disagree with those criticisms have the right to say so as well. But on the left, that ethos has been completely abandoned. No more defending the right of your opponents to say things that you disagree with. That's been replaced, that's been turned upside down. Speech is okay now only if it conforms to standards of correctness that the left itself developed. And if speech doesn't meet those standards of correctness, then it's not legitimate speech. It's not entitled to be defended. It's not allowed to be uttered. And that is an essential part of their strategy, because their ideas have failed everywhere they have ever been tried. They failed behind the Iron Curtain. They failed in South America. They failed in the inner cities of our own country. The only way the left advances their ideas is if they shut down the debate. And so that is what their strategy is. No more defending to the death the right of your opponents to say things you disagree with. That's been replaced with safe spaces, stripped of competitive ideas, purged of debate, where a whole worldview has been confined to a zone, a cone of silence and shame. And then along comes Donald Trump. And he says things that challenge that orthodoxy. And when he is called on it, he doesn't back down, he doubles down. He is not silent, he is not cowed, and they hate that. Because they know that in an open debate, their ideas cannot survive. That's why they hate him, and that's why we love him. Not because he's perfect, not because he's always right, but because he is challenging the people who would end freedom as we have always understood it. And that is why we must defend him. That is why we must defend President Trump even when he stumbles. I've been coming to these conventions all of my adult life. In 1991 at the Savannah Convention, Alec Poitevin, who was the state chairman, then hired me to be the executive director of the Georgia Republican Party. There were no statewide Republican elected officials. One of the 10 congressmen was a Republican, Newt Gingrich, and he had just been reelected by less than 900 votes. There were tiny minorities in both the House and in the Senate, and the number of Republican sheriffs was in the single digits. We were a full 10 years away from the governor's mansion and the successes that followed. And during that 10 or 15 year period of time, I've seen so many people this weekend who played an incredible role in moving our party to the position where it's now, where every statewide Republican elected official, majority of our congressional delegation, 2/3 majorities in both the House and the Senate, are overwhelmingly Republican. We did not do that just to put points on the scoreboard. We didn't do that just so certain people could hold elected offices. We did that because we expected our values to be translated into government action. And we have done that to an extent. We've got some accomplishments that we can point to. You know, here in Georgia, under Republicans, we maintained our AAA bond ratings during some very tough economic times. We continued to balance the budget. We kept our taxes low. We went from 2007 to 2009, our state budget went from $21 billion to $15.9 billion as we made cuts to accommodate declining revenue without raising taxes. And I remember I met with a lobbyist in my office at the Capitol. He said, Senator Shafer, she said, did you realize that we are number 50 in per capita spending, in per capita state spending? I said, you mean we spend more than anybody else? And she said, no, we spend less than anybody else. And I said, well, that should make us number one in per capita spending, because we believe in a limited government that is focused on its essential functions. I'm proud of what we as Republicans have collectively accomplished, and I'm proud of the things that I've worked on. I spent 8 years on zero-based budgeting, trying to pass legislation that was ultimately signed in 2011 by Governor Deal that requires every penny of state spending to be budgeted periodically. I'm proud of legislation that I pushed through that was sponsored by, that was signed by Governor Deal that requires all occupational regulations to be periodically rejustified. And I'm proud of a constitutional amendment that I sponsored 2 years ago that was approved overwhelmingly by the voters that caps the state income tax at 6%. But we've got more work to do, and we have got tough challenges ahead, which is why I am running for Lieutenant Governor. I want to close with a story. I struggled in Sunday school with some of the central lessons of Christianity, the parables of Jesus in particular. I had a hard time with the runaway son getting the feast, and the loyal son having to slaughter the fatted calf. I didn't entirely understand leaving the 99 sheep unguarded just because one sheep had gotten away. I had some trouble with turning the other cheek. I could understand running away if you weren't going to fight back, but standing there and allowing yourself to be beat. All of those things had to be explained to me. But there was one parable that I had no trouble understanding, that I got without any explanation at all. And it's the parable of the talents. For those of you who teach Sunday school, remember Sunday school. In that parable, there was a wealthy man who went on a long trip, and he divided his fortune among three managers, one of whom buried that fortune in the ground, the second of whom took the fortune and deposited it in the biblical equivalent of a bank, and the third of whom bought fields and flocks. No one had to explain to me that the one who had buried the treasure in the ground had done wrong, and the one who had bought the fields and the flocks had done right. I view public service through the prism of that parable. The titles that we hold, whether it's senator or chairman or representative or governor, in and of themselves, those titles don't mean anything. They're the treasure that's buried into the ground. What makes those titles meaningful is what we do with them. And if you elect me Lieutenant Governor, I promise you that I will spend every day in office using the title and the position that you've given me to implement the values and the ideas that we share. Thank you so very much for all you do for our Republican Party.
Thank you, David. All right, ladies and gentlemen.